Okay, Bismillah.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجهم ربي زدني علما ربي زدني فهما ربي زدني عملا وألحقني بالصالحين آمنا صدق الله العلي العظيم Mu'mineen, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and Eid Mubarak to all of you as well who are listening online. Alhamdulillah, we are now on to the second session of our discussion on comparing challenges and struggles faced by Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam and Prophet Musa alayhi salam. Last week, we talked about, just briefly from an bird's eye view, about the overall introduction as to what the origins of these two prophets were, what their positions were in society generally, with regards to their position and status vis-a-vis the kings that they were facing during their time, and what was the end of their saga or their prophethood with regards to the community that they were living with. Now we move along today with the challenges that were faced by both these two Israelite prophets, respectively, with regards to their parents. And if you will see the screen on your end as well, you will see that there is a chart that I have prepared to make it easier for you what we'll be talking today, inshallah. So on one side we have Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam, and on the other side we have Hazrat Musa alayhi salam. And so to begin with, first of all, from the Quranic point of view, the story of Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam starts with his father Ya'qub, who was also a prophet. And the story of Hazrat Musa alayhi salam starts with his mother. And in the Holy Quran, she is referred to as Musa. And that's the name that has been given to her. Not a specific name, she's just been mentioned as mother of Musa alayhi salam. And surprisingly, if you will notice that both these prophets in the Holy Quran, or generally in the biography as well, as far as Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam is concerned, there is no mention of the mother in the Quran at all. So she's absent from being mentioned. And likewise, in the case of Hazrat Musa alayhi salam, it's the flip side, where the father is absent from being mentioned. Now, we don't want to go into the nitty and gritty as to what happened with both the other parents for both these respective prophets. That's not our discussion at the time being. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in hindsight, is giving us a message that, listen, I'm giving you a story or a narrative of one prophet where the father was the caregiver of this prophet. And on the other side, I'm giving you a narrative and a story of a prophet where the mother was the caregiver of the prophet. So different scenarios and different challenges faced by both these two parents, respectively. Then we go to point number three. And in the case of Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam, Hazrat Ya'qub, which is his father, the challenge that he faced as a parent was an internal threat, and he was concerned about letting go of Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam. So the threat that Hazrat Yaqub alayhi salam faced was an internal one, meaning that these children that he had, Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam, mind you, had 11 brothers. Out of the 11, 10 of them were not from the same mother. They were from the same father, of course, but they didn't share the same mother. The only exception for Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam was his younger brother, which is Binyamin, who was his brother from the same father and mother as well. And so Hazrat Yaqub alayhi salam noticed that the other children, which is the other 10 sons, did not look at Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam in a favorable position, because they saw that his position with his father was different compared to the other sons. And so he was fearful, he was careful, he was protective of Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam, knowing that there was some sort of jealousy and ill feeling among the brothers as far as Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam is concerned, at a very young age. Now, one thing that comes into mind is that there definitely has to be something very charismatic about Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam at a very young age, not only his appearance as being very handsome, but other than that, his morals, his character must have been par excellence, which was missing in the other children, and probably that made them actually jealous or have a dislike towards Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam, because they saw that their father Hazrat Yaqub alayhi salam had a liking towards Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam more, and he was more protective and more concerned than the other siblings. Now, in the case of Hazrat Musa alayhi salam, the scenario is different. But before I go to that, I would just like to touch down on an ayah from the Holy Quran where we get the indication of the father Hazrat Yaqub alayhi salam for Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam being concerned and being protective. And this is when Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam comes to his father and mentions that he sees in his dream, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, is qala Yusufu li abihi ya abati يا أبت إني رأيت أحد عشر كوكبا والشمس والقمر رأيتهم لساجدين. This is in the beginning of Surah Yusuf. And immediately when Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam tells about what he sees to his father, the father responds back. The following ayah, which is ayah number 5 in chapter number 12, where the father responds, قَالَ يَا بُنَيَّ لا تقصص رؤياك على أخواتك فيكيد كيدا. And the translation is there. He said, "Oh my son, relate not your dream to your brothers, lest they contrive a plot against you. For Satan is to man an open enemy." And so this already gives an indication that the father is telling his son, "Keep this to yourself. Do not mention it, because your brothers will not take this in a positive manner and will use that or manipulate against you." In the other instance, which is in verse number 13, again chapter 12, we have another ayah where I'll just go to the English translation because of time constraint, where he says, Hazrat Yaqub alayhi salam tells his son, when they ask him, why is he not letting Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam go and play with them and go out with them, basically. And the first excuse that he gives is, he said, it grieves me that you should take him away. So he was concerned about letting go of Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam. He was being protective here. Because he feared, he saw what was brewing in the hearts of the other sons, which was visible from his point of view, that you should take him away, and I fear lest the wolf should devour him while you are heedless of him. Now, that was another excuse he was giving just to discourage or to make the other sons not persuade him to take Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam. Of course, bearing in mind that they were a shepherd family and living out in the open or living in the area, they were prone to wild animals attacking them. And so that's where Hazrat Yaqub alayhi salam is giving an excuse that I'm scared that a wolf might devour my young son whilst you are going to be heedless of him outside. Now, in the case of Hazrat Musa alayhi salam, the mother is not fearful or not scared of an internal threat. Rather, she is fearful of external threat and concerned about letting go. Both the parents are concerned about letting go of their child, but one is facing an internal threat and the other is facing an external threat. The external threat that is faced by the mother of Hazrat Musa alayhi salam is the Pharaoh, who had given an order that all male children of the Israelite, as soon as they're born, they should be killed because of what the magicians had told him, that there would be one Israelite baby that would be born amongst the Israelites that would bring an end to your rule, as he would guide the Israelites and be a prophet that would hail from amongst them. And so she was fearful of the external threat of the policeman finding out about this new baby and killing Hazrat Musa alayhi salam. So she was concerned about an external threat and was cautious of letting go of her child, and was protective to make sure that nobody finds out. Now, in the case of Hazrat Musa alayhi salam, of course, we have to realize that he did not have as many siblings as Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam had. He only had one elder sister and one brother, which is Hazrat Harun alayhi salam. So, which is a contrast, yes, compared to what Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam faced as far as siblings are concerned. But nevertheless, in the case of Hazrat Musa alayhi salam, Hazrat Musa alayhi salam did not have any problems as far as the siblings were concerned. Both the sister, his elder sister, of course, and Hazrat Harun alayhi salam, who came later on, were basically his helpers and were supportive of him in his mission and cared about him. So he did not have an issue as far as jealousy or ill feeling amongst the siblings. So mother did not have this problem. And we go to point number four. In a way, this scenario of siblings, rationally, when you look at it, when you have more siblings in a family, it can be beneficial for you. It can be support. It can be strength for you as well, if you are all in harmony, and if you all have love and care and support of each other, which is perfectly fine. But in many cases, it can also be a threat to you, or a challenge, or an obstacle, where one brother or sister might be doing well in terms of academic studies or financially or otherwise, and the others might not be doing as well as the other brother or sister, and rivalry or jealousy or ill feeling might come upon and cause a barrier or cause even a harm to that person. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing us here that in the case of Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam, this is exactly what happened. That because of the scenario of Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam, the other brothers decided to do something very harmful towards Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam, and they planned something, and they did it. They were able to do what they wanted to. Now, point number four. In the case of Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam, father lets go by pressure from the sons. Okay, as I mentioned earlier, that father, the Hazrat Yaqub alayhi salam, was fearful of the internal threat and concern, but he finally gives in to this pressure from his sons, who keep on telling him that why is it that you do not let Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam go with us? And this is there again in chapter 12, ayah number 11 and 12, where they tell him the other 10 brothers of Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam, mind you, the Binyamin, who was the younger brother of Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam, was very young, very young. He was probably in his early infancy age, so he was not in the picture at that time and did not even know what was happening with regards to his brother Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam and the other brothers during that time. And so the Quran is telling us in this chapter, ayah number 11, قَالُوا يَا أَبَانَا مَا لَكَ لَا تَعْمَنَّ عَلَى يُوسُفَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. And then the following ayat, أَرْسِلْهُ مَعَنَا غَدًا يَرْفَعُ يَرْتَعُ وَيَلْعَبُ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. Now when you look at these two ayah, which is ayah number 11 and ayah number 12, there's some very powerful words that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has used here. In ayah number 11, towards the end, the brothers are saying, وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ, that we are sincerely his well wishes, O Father. Why do you not give us Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam to go and play with us and have fun? And in the second ayah, which is ayah number 12, they say, وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ, surely we are his protectors, we will be keeping guard over him. And these are the words that they use towards Hazrat Yaqub alayhi salam in explaining or in telling their father that, you know, we will protect him and we are his well-wishers. And so please let Yusuf alayhi salam go with us tomorrow and play with us and have fun with us. And so because of this pressure from the other 10 sons, he finally decides to let Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam go the following day. You can just imagine, picture in your mind, you have 10 sons who are, you know, just around you and telling you, oh father, why don't you let our younger brother go with us tomorrow and enjoy and have fun as well and play with us as well. And so Hazrat Yaqub alayhi salam, because of the pressure from the other 10 sons, lets him go, and he did not want to escalate already that rivalry and that ill feeling that the brothers had, which he could notice go to a further level by refusing or not letting Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam go. In the case of Hazrat Musa alayhi salam, this was not the case. Mind you, at that time he only had his sister who was there, and so the mother does not let go from any pressure as far as the children are concerned, but she lets go because of revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is again seen further down in my notes in chapter 28, Surah Al-Qasas, ayah number 7. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling, and I'll just go to the quickly to the English translation. And we reveal to the mother of Moses, saying, "Suckle him." وَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَىٰ أُمِّ مُوسَىٰ أَنْ أَرْضِعِيهِ. And when you fear for him, see again here, Allah is saying, when you fear for his life, when you fear that the soldiers or the policemen find out or come to know that there's a baby here within an Israelite family, then cast him into the river and fear not. no grief, for we shall restore him back to you and shall make him one of the messengers. So she lets go of Hazrat Musa alayhi salam from revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells her that to protect your son, let him go and put him in a casket and let him float alongside the river, and do not worry, we shall protect him, and not only that, but we shall return him back to you soon, and we shall raise him amongst the prophet. I think we're almost done with our time slot of 20 minutes, so I will stop here today, and inshallah we'll continue next Sunday. وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين. If there are any questions that anybody has, please feel free to ask.
Thank you, Sheikh. If anyone has a question, you can enter it into the chat, and we'll answer it. Questions. People are entering any questions they have. Sheikh, do you want to give us a little bit of a sneak peek of what you have in mind for us next week, where I get an idea better of where you're going?
Yes. Yeah. Obviously, inshallah, I will finish with what I've started today. We're not able to complete our discussion. We're just we finished about point number four, so I have 3 points left in this part of the presentation. And then next Sunday, inshallah, God willing, we will be comparing the challenges by both these two respective prophets as far as the siblings are concerned. So we have started our discussion as far as the challenges faced by the parents of both these two respective prophets. And then we will move on to the challenges as far as the siblings are concerned with both these two prophets and move from there, inshallah.
I'm not seeing any questions at the time. Do you? We have about 7 more minutes. Do you want to continue for one or two more points?
Sure. If time permits, I can definitely do so.
We've got a good 7 minutes. If you want, we can continue.
Okay, so that's perfectly fine. As I mentioned, that the mother of Hazrat Musa alayhi salam let go by revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have to picture in mind that, you know, when it comes to custody and when it comes to protection of children, generally speaking, mothers are more protective, concerned about the well-being and safety of their child than fathers are, generally speaking. It doesn't mean that fathers are not. No, fathers definitely are protective and do care for their children as well. But mothers, by nature, by instinct nature that they have been given, are more protective. And so it is not easy for Hazrat Musa alayhi salam's mother to let go of her child facing the external threats that were around. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought tranquility into her heart by revelation and by calming her and by assuring her that he is the one who is going to be protecting him. And not only that, but he shall return the child back to her mother very soon and will raise him amongst the prophets. Now, point number five. After pressure from the children, Hazrat Yaqub alayhi salam basically has no exception but to do sabr. Now, this is after the fact that when he had given permission to Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam to go with his brothers out and play. And the plot that these brothers had plotted as far as what they wanted to do, and they put him inside a well, and they abandon him, and they come back to their father, crying and saying, you know, that Father, I don't know where you got this notion from, but what you said earlier was exactly what happened. We were playing and we were heedless of our brother, and the wolf attacked and ate him. And this is the shirt we have of the blood which is there. And so when this saga happens, which they tell to their father, the ayah which is in the Quran, which is again chapter number 12, ayah number 18, which is, again, I'll just do the English translation. When he hears that, what they have to say, the brothers, he says, "Nay, but your souls have made a great thing appear very light in your eyes. So now patience is good for me. فَصَبْرٌ جَمِيلٌ. I have no course of action but to do sabr in this case." Now, surprisingly, these are the words that Hazrat Yaqub alayhi salam uses when he hears what the brothers have to say about Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam. And later on, in the same chapter, ayah number 83, he uses the same words. This is in the case when the brothers later on, when they take Benjamin to Misr, so that they may get his portion of wheat from the king. And so they take him with the permission, of course, from Hazrat Yaqub alayhi salam, and bring him over in Misr. And then as the plot is done by Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam in Misr to keep his younger brother, Benjamin, with him, of course, he has a mission in mind. And when the same thing happens, when the brothers go back to Canaan without Benjamin, they realize that there was a time that they had come back to their father without their younger brother, Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam. And now they're going back again and have taken Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam's younger brother and coming back without him. And they tell Hazrat Yaqub alayhi salam what happened in Misr, and that Benjamin was caught stealing something that did not belong to him. Hazrat Yaqub alayhi salam, again, after hearing this, uses the same words. قَالَ بَلْ صَوَرْ لَكُمْ أَنفُسَكُمْ أَمْرًا فَصَبْرٌ جَمِيلٌ. So in the case of Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam, he uses the same words. And in the case of Benjamin, he uses the same words. Now, as far as Hazrat Musa alayhi salam is concerned, the mother has an option. As I mentioned, that there was no rivalry amongst the siblings, because it was only the sister there. And so although she lets go of Hazrat Musa alayhi salam by revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but when she lets go of Hazrat Musa in a basket and it's floating along the river, she doesn't walk away from that. You know, she instructs her daughter, or she tells her daughter, that, you know, go outside and follow that basket which is floating in the river, and keep an eye on it and see what is happening. And we can see that in chapter number 28, ayah number 11, the English translation again. And she says to his sister, referring to Hazrat Musa alayhi salam's sister, follow him up, you know, and keep an eye on him. So she observed him from afar, and they knew not of her relationship. This is, well, she could see from far that there were guards and there were policemen keeping an eye on what was happening outside the palace. And so from a distance, she was keeping an eye on that basket which was floating along the river and going towards the castle. So she could keep an eye on the basket and see what is happening to her younger brother, which is in that basket as advised or as instructed by her mother. And so the mother of Hazrat Musa alayhi salam, at least to some point, had that aspect of, although letting her son go, she could let her daughter go and just keep an eye from a distance to see what is happening to Hazrat Musa alayhi salam. I think we've almost finished our slot of again 6 or 7 minutes, so we should stop here.
Thank you. Yeah, Sheikh, there is just one question. Did the brothers do something to the youngest brother of Prophet Yusuf as well?
Yeah, good question. As far as the story is concerned, in the Quran, we do not have any mention of them causing any harm as far as Benjamin is concerned. And we do not see that as well when we look at the books of history. If you go to Hayatul Qulub and other books of history, they don't mention that they did anything harmful to Benjamin the way they did to Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam. Obviously, the scenario for Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam was different. He was a prophet, of course, and his charisma and personality was different from his younger brother Benjamin. And so that rivalry was not seen as far as Benjamin is concerned with the other brothers, no.
And how many brothers did Prophet Yusuf have from the same father and mother?
Just one, Benjamin. Benjamin and Hazrat Yusuf alayhi salam were the only two brothers from the same father and mother.
Excellent, thank you. Let's end here today. Thank you so much for these slides. It's really good to see the side-by-side comparison. We read these surahs all the time, and sometimes these comparisons go right over us. So you bringing this out is really remarkable. Thank you for the time and putting this together. Thanks, everyone, for joining us again this week, and hope to see you again next weekend at the same time. Continue to stay healthy, stay safe, and we'll see you again. Take care. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Ahsant. Khuda hafiz.